Hello, and you are listening to the Book Was Better podcast, the podcast where we talk about the book of the film. I'm Luke.
I'm Lauren.
And this week, we're going to the prom.
Hey, you. Hey, you. Put down the popcorn and turn on the light. It's gonna be all right, my friend. In the end, take my hand and trust me, the book was better.
Holy crap, I am here with Lauren. Hello.
Hello.
From America. Been a while since we've done a America cast.
I know, it's weird. You know, I got up early today. I got my hair done. I got my makeup. I'm in my pretty dress.
You look fantastic.
Well, thank you. But, you know, I have to ask you something, Luke.
Yes.
Where's my corsage?
Yeah, that's what I was getting on. You didn't get that? I sent it by Amazon drone.
Oh, no. It must have gotten lost along the way.
Oh, that's really disappointing. Yeah. It was beautiful. It was really large, too.
Oh, darn. You know, I love big ostentatious things, being American.
Well, that's right. And it was, cheeseburger shaped.
Sweet. Did it have that smell of, like, rotting meat and cheese?
Yeah, it was, like, meat, cheese, then a handgun, then some stars, then some stripes, then some bald eagle feathers, and then a more cheese.
And then extra some cheese.
Spray cheese, then some cheese popcorn, and the top was a, I can't think of an American chocolate bar.
Hershey's.
There we go.
Snickers.
Snickers, yeah, and peanut butter. You would want to put peanut butter in that, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Lauren, I have so many questions for you about this prom. This is so exciting that you're going to go to my, well, this is my first prom. We're both, it's kind of weird. The listeners won't be able to see this. We've both gone to separate gymnasiums on opposite sides of the world. I'm standing here in a tuxedo, a powder blue next to a bowl of punch. I'm the only one here. But this is going to be really great. This is going to be quite the experience. I didn't even know this film existed. Had you heard of it?
Sadly, yes, I had heard of it. it's Disney, so it's everywhere. Oh, yeah. I think it was pretty popular, I think, among the youngins.
Like High School Musical kind of popular? Are we talking about something that's in that kind of vein?
Well, this was an actual movie released in theaters, not a TV movie like High School Musical, but it doesn't have any musical. So,
no, that's true.
And one thing that always bothers me is that it should be, it's The Prom, not Prom.
The Prom.
I hate that.
Prom is short for promenade?
That's right. I researched it for you a little bit here.
Oh, great. See, because normally, you know, we get into this pretty quick. But, you know, look, this is our two great nations, you know, shaking hands over the divide. Not even just shaking hands, like drinking punch and dancing.
Dancing the electric slide.
Yeah, so I feel like, you know, we need to spend that little bit of time before we get into this stupid book to sort of get to know each other and talk prom, talk about our prom experiences.
It's called padding, Luke, right? We know padding, all about it.
Yeah, that's absolutely.
Well, the prom started in the late 1800s at colleges where they would have a fancy tea for the seniors before they graduated. And it was called the promenade, and you would be paraded around by your date to show off your dress. That's what it was. And now it's in the high schools.
Okay. See, we have the school ball, which is pretty much the same thing.
Yeah.
Except with far less pageantry. Like, we don't have a king or queen or anything like that.
Yeah, that's always weird to me. Like, at my school, we voted for king and queen in homeroom, which is where you get your attendance taken in the morning.
Yeah. We call that tutor group.
Oh, okay. And my homeroom actually didn't get to vote because my teacher thought it was stupid. So you voted and they picked the top five boys and the top five girls, and then they picked out of a hat who was the king and queen.
Right, and so these people, the king and queen, are not necessarily in a relationship or dating or anything.
Not at my school. I think it became too much of a popularity contest and caused too much drama, so they just would pick out of a hat.
Do they get to go home together?
That's up to them, really.
Okay. It's not legally enforced or anything
like that. No, it's not legally binding.
Okay. See, we have... See, I'm going to have to get your information on all the things like sophomore and freshman and all these kind of things, because we don't have any of that. The way ours works is when you're about five, you go to year one, and then you go all the way through to year 12 when you're about 17. You can finish at year 10 if you want to go into a trade or something like that. But if you want to go to university, you go all the way up to year 12. High school is from about year 7 or 8. And then after year 12, you can go to university or get a job or do whatever. But we had a school ball in both year 11 and 12.
Yes, we did as well.
Pretty wretched.
Well, what we do here is we have at age 5, you go to kindergarten.
Yeah.
And then 1, 2, 3, 4 through 12. 7 starts junior high or middle school.
Okay.
And then 9, 9 through 12 is high school. So 9th grade is freshman. 10th grade sophomore, 11 junior, 12 senior.
Why you gotta complicate things, America?
We like to put our own stamp on other people's stuff and say that we invented it, right?
Yeah. I like that. That's, what do they call that? That's appropriation.
Right. Well, my school was very small. From 7 to 12, we only had about 1,000 kids. So we had a junior-senior prom. So 11 and 12 had to go to the same prom.
Yeah, I think ours was, no, ours was separate. And the year 11 one was just wretched. I was obsessed with this girl who was way out of my league. She was like, you know, was the head girl and was really popular. But the problem was, like, if she was someone like that who just completely ignored me, it would have been easier. But we were actually at one point quite good friends. And I asked her to go with me, and she was like, well, you know, I don't know yet, but like, why don't we'll get photos taken and stuff. And I was like, oh, okay. And then when I went there, and I was like really, really skinny and wearing this horrible tuxedo. My mom used to have photos of me. When I went there, like, she got back together with her. She didn't talk to me all night, and she got back together with her ex-boyfriend, who had like an orange mullet.
Oh, the mullet.
Because this was like about 92. So I was just, yeah, I was just really miserable all night. I hated it.
92? Oh, man. Sorry, I was in 7th grade. oh, Nirvana. Anyway, 92.
Yeah, 92, yeah. And then year 12, I still didn't go with anyone, but I was hanging out with all the, like, kids that listened to Nirvana and introduced me to a lot of music. And we had a really crappy band. We were called Visit Uncle Ned and Co. because it was written on my friend's calendar, who was the drummer, that on a certain date they had to visit Uncle Ned and Co. And we played, like, 3 songs, I think, at the ball. And I was on keyboard, and I don't really know how to play keyboard. So I was okay. I faked it through. We did a cover of L7's Pretend That We're Dead, which has a keyboard bit. But then there was this song, which I didn't even really know that it was an original that Matt, the lead singer guy, was like kind of making up. So I just played, and the guy that was on the desk, mixing desk, I think just turned me right down. So I don't even think anybody could hear me.
Your prom stories are better than mine.
And that night I ended up actually in bed with a female friend from my drama class. And nothing like that happened. I think we kissed. And I spent the night there.
Mm-hmm.
She was a really nice girl. Like, I should have, you know, pursued that. And I didn't. So what about you? What are your stories?
I was not the coolest chick in the world in high school. I was in the band, trombone.
Oh, yeah.
And played the tuba in college. Anyway, so my friends and I had no prospects for dates. I never had a date in high school. No, never kissed a girl, nothing. I never kissed a girl. I never kissed a boy either. Ooh, that was a slip. I hope no parishioners are listening right now.
No.
I gotta watch what I say. Yes, so in 11th grade when we had the prom, we just all went together. I think only one of us had a boyfriend, but he was one of our friends. They're actually married now, so I'm going to talk about that too, high school relationships.
Did you going to say that he was married then?
No, he wasn't married then. I don't think so. So we all just went together and had a great time. And then we went to my friend Kelly's house and had a sleepover.
Yeah.
And we didn't drink or anything, you know, so it was fun. And then senior year, I had a crush on my friend.
Yeah.
John. And we were best friends. And he was not interested. And it turns out, you know, he's gay. And he's married to a lovely guy now. So I took my gay best friend to prom.
That's kind of cool, though. That's a better... I'd rather, like, the person that I was interested in turned out to be gay than turned out to be interested in a guy with an orange mullet. Like, that...
Right, well, he might have been interested in a guy with an orange mullet.
That was an insult to injury right there. Yeah.
And then we had... the school sponsored an after-prom party, which was all night, and it was free because they didn't want everybody to go. I grew up in kind of like the boonies, you know, so everybody would go to the woods and drink or whatever. So the school hosted this after-prom party, which was all night. So they took us to like the sports facility where we could play video games and play a sports facility with video games. There you go, America. But, you could play tennis, or kickball, or basketball, or whatever. And then they took us to the beach to watch the sunrise. And then we had to get picked up by our parents because 2 years earlier, a girl drove herself home and hit a tree and died. She fell asleep. Or maybe she didn't die, but it was not good.
She died, but she got better.
She got better, yeah.
Yeah, that's great.
I don't remember if she died. Maybe just in my head. But we had fun. I mean, it was really good fun, you know, straight-laced and... Good time.
I mean, no one was cool. Let's be straight. No one was cool in high school. Everybody says, I wasn't that cool in high school. Nobody was cool. I look at the kids in school today and none of them are cool. I think like university is like when you start to find yourself a bit more.
That's true. That's true. And then the people who were considered cool in high school, like I saw them at my reunion and this guy comes up to me and he's like, oh my God, Lauren, how are you? It's so great to see you again. Yada, yada. I hear you live in New York now, which is a big deal. I live in New York. And I was like, yeah, who are you? And it turns out he was like the star soccer player or something. And I was like, I don't know who you are, dude. And he was so crushed that this nerd didn't know who he was.
Tried to borrow a dollar. Tried to bum a cigarette.
Right. I did smoke back then.
I didn't know you lived in New York. So how do you deal with all the clover fields and Lokis and Ninja Turtles and all that sort of stuff?
Oh, yeah. I lived in Chelsea for 3 years because that's where my seminary is, right in the gayest part of New York City.
Mm.
And we did have a lot of Lokis and Ninja Turtles. But you know what? Ninja Turtles aren't bad because you just give them some pizza and they leave you alone.
What about, like, when the Statue of Liberty's head is rolling down the street and, like, crushing everything in its path?
I had to be careful what music I played because whenever I would play, you know, your love is lifting,
it
would come
that.
Down the street.
That'll come to my door. It lifting its toga up.
Yeah.
For sure. Well, look, I'm sure we're going to have more prom memories and plenty more information from you as we go into the specifics of this book. It was adapted by Ellie O'Ryan. Now, here's an author, Lauren. Disney Fairies, The Secret of the Wings, read-along storybook and CD.
Oh, I wonder if they still use that same beep noise that they had when we were little on the tapes.
Turn the page. When you hear the chimes ring like this.
Yep.
Platypus Power, read-along storybook and CD. I don't know if she's really in a position to start talking shit about platypuses.
I know. Is that like white power? Platypus power?
Yeah.
They want to exterminate every other monotreme?
They're very racist against ducks.
Oh, I see. Because they're very similar.
And beavers. Don't like those either.
Who isn't? Yeah.
Oh, this is interesting. The Case of the Digital Deception, CSI.
Oh, Club CSI.
Club CSI. What's Club CSI? Is that like a junior version? No, no.
I don't even know. It sounds like it. Like you could do your own forensic investigations at home. Like, give me that swab, Mom.
Sort of like CSI crossed with the Burger King Kids Club, maybe. Those guys. Like the kid with the big plastic sunglasses and the spiky hair and comes around to investigate a rape. Littlest Pet Shop. Life's Littlest Lessons. Like the sound of that one. This sounds just like words put together. Angel Cat Sugar, : Wish for a Wand. Angel Cat Sugar.
Sugar.
Yeah. And our finally...
Is that an angel?
Sharpay's Fabulous Adventure, junior novelization.
That took me a minute to realize it was High School Musical.
Yeah, I have a feeling that we're probably going to have to cover that at some point, because Jess and I, obviously, we did the three High School Musical books. I feel like the Sharpay spinoff could be necessary. I quite like Sharpay.
I have no idea why they named her that. That's just one of those things. Like, what?
So, at the beginning, now let's take turns here. We'll alternate parts. This is tricky over Skype, but we're gonna handle it. Senior year, second semester, 6 weeks until graduation, 6 weeks until the end of high school.
3 weeks until prom.
For Nova Prescott, the counting down had started a long time ago. Back in freshman year, on the very first day of school, 720 school days, 574 shifts at part-time jobs, 423 chances to cheer for the home team, 285 multiple-choice tests, 119 lab experiments, 56 semester grades, 27 assigned books, 16 all-nighters, 7 college applications, 4 yearbook pitches. It all added up to 4 crazy, busy, action-packed, drama-filled years of high school.
But there was only one prom. One night out on that dance floor under those twinkling lights, and all those memories would come into intense focus and completely fade away, all at the same time. A night worth all the effort and all the planning. A night worth holding on to.
Wow. I feel like my high school stats would be very, very different to that.
And what kind of name is Nova? You know, it reminds me of American Pie. You see that movie?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The Chris Klein guy, he's like, I'm Nova, like Casanova, suck me beautiful.
I do remember that. I can't believe that guy had sex with a pie, though. That's crazy.
Oh, well, I've heard weirder things.
And then he did it again, in the sequel, they kept doing it.
You haven't watched much German porn, have you?
Well, yeah. I shouldn't tell that story. I used to, for a little while in university, under a pseudonym, I had a job because I was working with, in drama. I was in the drama classes. And one of the girls there went from doing a sex line to, which is great for an actor, to running a, sex shop, was like doing their website stuff, an online sex shop. And she recruited a bunch of us who had written plays and were writers to review films. And it's really funny because you can say anything and you're not going to affect the sales. Like, it's the only time when you can review something. And you can say that it's the most horrible thing, but if someone's into that, then they're going to get it anyway. So I used to write just the craziest nonsense, and it just never affected sales. Crazy. So there you go.
It's good to know that your hard work has no effect on anything. That's always a good feeling.
Well, I remember someone going, like, looking at one of my reviews and going, oh, but you've told everything that happened. Like, why would someone want to watch it now? And I was like, I don't know if they're there for the plot. No, but you reminded me by saying the German thing, because you couldn't just take all the nice, like, American ones. There was always, like, if you're going to get these 10 to review, you've got to pick something else as well, because, otherwise they won't go. Horrible, demeaning job, terrible thing. We were all so young and stupid back then.
Yes.
So Nova, she's the class president and head of the prom committee. So I guess she's got a lot of responsibility, like buying ingredients for punch and
spiking said punch,
sticking things to walls and stuff. It sounds like a big job.
Yeah, that's the weird thing about these books. Like, the prom is usually at a banquet hall, and you have dinner, and then you dance. Like, you know, where you go for a wedding or something.
Yeah,
They never have them in the gym. That's awful. You can't have high heels on that gym floor. Like, no. And who's going to clean up after that? The janitor? No.
All ours are in hotels.
Yeah, so there's no real need to plan anything. I don't really know why all these movies have all this crap. Or, I don't know. Or they wouldn't have a movie, right?
I guess so, yeah. Yeah, so it's a myth. Prom is a myth, yep. as we know it.
It is.
It's because of... I reckon it all stems from the enchantment under the sea ball in Back to the Future.
Right. Well, I think back then they probably were all in gyms. I think it probably started out that way.
I can't imagine
but nowadays it's not.
Mr. Strickland getting everyone a hotel back in 1955.
Well, that's what those big back seats were for in those big cars.
Bunch of slackers. I thought they were for molesting your mother so that she fell in love with your father.
That too.
Yeah.
That's what it said. Buy the new Dodge. It's good for molesting your mother so your father will
fall in love. Yeah. So your father will punch your lights out and then and then seed you. Look, this is right off the bat a really crazy bit of writing here. There it was, the big pink bakery box she'd smuggled into school that morning, completely untouched, and all thanks to the lock part of her locker. And no thanks to the part of her locker, I might add. I didn't even know that. That's why they call them lockers, I guess, because of the lock.
Right, because it's locked.
That's amazing. So she has baked cookies to lure her committee friends like Ali and the dreamy Brandon. Check out this guy.
Nova looked up to see Brandon Roberts standing there with a half smile across his lips that always made her heart skip a beat. She pointed at him. Double chocolate chip cookie, right? Ooh, blah. Nope, I thought I was going to do good and be able to read.
No, that's apparently. Okay. Like, not many of our guests can read. That's fine. It's not a...
I read for a living, so you know. Double chocolate chip, right? My favorite.
Hey, come on. Those U's, that's English. You can't just skip letters.
My favorite, he announced as he strolled into the room. His sky blue polo shirt matched his eyes perfectly. Nova noticed a quick, self-conscious glance in his direction. As always, every copper hair on his head was carefully gelled into place.
Oh, swoon. He sounds like a dreamboat, doesn't he?
Unrequited teenage love is such a big theme.
Double chocolate chip.
That's too many chocolates, I think.
That's two chocolates plus the chocolate chip.
Sounds insane. Like a diabetes waiting to happen.
Yeah, do you notice, like, all the kids, that's how they're lured into voting. They smell these cookies and they all come out of their hidey holes. And other attendees here are the stylish Mae Kwon and Rollo, who's pretty much the blonde, curly-haired stoner who isn't actually stoned because it's a Disney movie. And he's certainly lured out of his nest by the promise of cookies.
I love Rollo. He's my fave.
He's your favorite. Well, I guess it's got to be someone's favorite. You know, I didn't even have a favorite in this one. Like, you know, High School Musical, at least I can go, you know, the girls are cute and, you know, I like the sassy boy with the fancy hat, Sharpay's brother.
Mm-hmm.
But
I've never seen that.
Oh, Lauren, that's unpatriotic. You got to sort that out immediately. All right, here we go. Everyone, even Nova, laughed at the memory of last year's prom. The stories were legendary. Voting for prom court took place at the dance itself, and the ballot box has been stuffed with hundreds of fake ballots. When all the votes were counted, Spider-Man and Mrs. Potato Head would have been crowned king and queen of prom if Principal Dunnan hadn't called the whole thing off. Which is fair, because technically, Mrs. Potato Head, she is married, so...
Mr. Potato Head is very jealous.
That's true. Can you imagine Mr. Potato Head swinging, coming at Spider-Man? Like, that guy has fought a lizard, he's fought a rhino, he's fought a vulture. Mr. Potato Head would fit right in there.
He'd be fries.
Amazing Spider-Man. That's what Spider-Man would say. You're fries!
You're fries.
Potato Head.
There's this creepy commercial now for Lay's potato chips here, where Mr. Potato Head comes home from work, and he's looking for Mrs. Potato Head, and he hears crunching noises, and he finds her in the closet eating Lay's potato chips.
Oh, cannibalism.
And he goes, and then he eats one. So it's weird. It's like promoting cannibalism.
Do you reckon that when they're getting intimate, he ever puts his hand in the little compartment in the back?
Well, why? What else is that compartment for?
I guess so. Storing ears. So look, this prom planning goes on for pages, including planning the posters, the advertising, the ticket design, the decorations, working out all their conflicting schedules. After a while there, it felt like I was reading the full minutes of an actual meeting.
Yeah, and this stuff isn't actually in the movie.
Oh yeah, it reminded me of like 50 Shades of Grey, which I read because Courtney made me, because we were going to do a podcast about it, where you have to read their entire contract, like... I felt like I would have to sign it and date it at the end of it. It was crazy.
You know, if I want to see something like 50 Shades of Grey, I'll just watch Secretary again.
Mm.
I mean, I own that on DVD, so...
And that is a good film.
Yeah, I mean, why read porn light if you can just
it's
go
not porn,
get a
though.
Porno
it's
book?
It's just like complete... Well, like, there's a tiny bit, but it's mostly just... I'm surprised that people were able to stick with it long enough to even get to the porn, because it takes forever.
I see a lot of women on the subway reading that.
It's for people that don't know about the internet. So
like, I'm hacking the mainframe.
Yeah. So Nova leaves, wondering if the dreamy Brandon really likes her and will ask her to the prom. This confused me. But like, if they like each other, they can just tell each other now, right, and get down to business. They don't need to wait 6 weeks for this... sanctioned dance with Principal Dunnan like looking over them.
Yeah, but that's high school, right? Like you liked that girl, you said, and you didn't tell her. High school's like that. Hopefully adulthood is not like that, but
yeah,
it is sometimes.
that was more like I was just chasing the wrong people. Like I was chasing some people that just weren't ever going to happen and that weren't what I thought they were. And I let some really genuinely nice people just slip by who I could have, you know, I wanted a girlfriend more than anything in high school. And I could have had one, like a really nice girl, like people that I just think you were lovely. Like, and you genuinely liked me. You liked what I was into. Why did I like this other crazy girl?
Yeah. Don't we all ask that same question?
And the answer is hormones.
Yeah. And don't look back on the past. The past, past. Well, I get philosophical on you.
No, please do. That's what this show needs. I've got you here to class things up, Lauren.
Oh yeah, I'll start preaching at you. And I've already talked about German porn and classing things right up.
Well, that was my fault, surely. Take all the
action typing, right?
Action typing, yes. That's one of my favorite things. The next night, Nova was typing about 1,000 words a minute as she worked on her English paper for Mr. Geiss's class. This made me think, because I reckon this book's about 30 to 40,000 words, so I wouldn't be surprised if it was written in 30 to 40 minutes. How's that kind of feel?
Yeah.
Don't look
yeah,
back?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's generous. Maybe 15.
And she has an IM chat with, that's Instant Messenger for all you kids out there, with Brandon. And the whole boring conversation is recorded like it's the worst play script ever. They talk about
yeah.
their assignments. And Nova's IM name is Novalicious. And he's just called Brandon. And I felt like we needed to think up a better name for him.
Yeah, the only way that he would be Brandon is if he, like, invented IMing and was the first one on board in, like, whatever year the internet started, right? 1990 or something. And I noticed, too, that she writes in that horrible shorthand, like, the letter R, the letter U, you know, that kind of stuff. And he writes whole words.
See, they were never meant to be together.
Chats. Yeah. But I came up with one for Brandon. So we say Bryn Dog, D-A-W-G, 69, of course.
Oh, I love
Bryn
that.
Bryn Dog, 69.
I love that. I'd like to see Bran adopt that in Game of Thrones.
Oh, yeah, I don't watch Game of Thrones.
Lauren, we've got to sort all this out.
I'm busy. I have two jobs.
I have a life.
Wine. I try to have a life.
Yeah, this is an example of that Novalicious thing you were talking about. Way two, number two, go. Listen, I gotta get back to this. Letter C, letter U, at symbol, prom, CMTE, that's committee, meeting, on Thursday.
Meeting.
Yeah, like what is she, an Amazon reviewer? It's gibberish.
Yeah, and it does not take too long to type out whole words.
Yeah, and then Allie joins the conversation, and she just is even worse. She says, OMG, he is so gonna ask letter U, number two, prom. Like, how can I relate to these miserable illiterates in this book? We are better than this. I thought this was a school that these kids went to. This is insane.
No kidding. And Nova is the valedictorian with a full college scholarship to, like, where? I forget. But a full college scholarship. And her friends don't type like that, which is, like...
If you can write 1,000 words a minute, you don't need to start cutting corners.
I know. It's just kids today.
What do you think of this quote here?
But this time, there was a huge smile on her face, and it didn't have anything to do with her typing skills.
Who would assume that? Like, why would you think that it was because of her typing skills? That's insane. And then Father Frank comes in to deliver some encouragement and basically clunky exposition. Her scholarship
exposition, to Dad.
Georgetown is on final semester grades. Like, she won't get it if she doesn't do well. So, I don't know, like, is that why she doesn't have time to write full sentences? It's really bizarre.
You know, planning the prom is just so time-consuming that she really has to shave that extra 10 seconds off her life.
That is very true. And then she has a lunch with Brandon in the library, which they totally diss the library. I'm not a fan of that. And it's
no
just...
eating in the library. No eating.
You never eat in a library. That's ridiculous. But it's an incredibly just mundane, sleep-inducing conversation about prom court voting, rejecting computers, and implementing a steel lockbox, and getting the teachers involved. It's just crazy. Like, we're hearing every thought that is coming. Like, it's event management. It's not a story.
Yeah, and you know what they have for lunch was a power bar. And that's just poor nutrition example for kids. You shouldn't eat power bars for lunch, kids.
No.
That's not good. You have to have a balanced meal.
What about that, like, whole school cafeteria where people go up with the tray and someone pours slop onto their tray like they're in prison? Is that, how does that happen? And gives them a little carton of milk?
No, that doesn't happen, really. My aunt was the lunch lady at my school, actually.
Oh.
And our food was really good. So... Well, you do take the tray up, but you get a choice of different foods. But they just determined later last year that pizza counts as a vegetable because it has tomato sauce.
Oh, well, that's fantastic.
Because they're trying to do school food reform in this country. So they said, no, pizza is totally a vegetable. Isn't that nice?
Could be worse. Here we go. You do this one, Nova.
All right. Nova was so distracted that she nearly ran right into Jordan Lundley, the most popular girl at Brookside. Jordan wasn't popular because she was rich or connected or anything like that. It was because she was genuinely nice to everyone she met.
Oh, she sounds like a witch. Let's burn her. Again, why would we assume, oh, well, she must be rich and connected if people like her? She's making all these assumptions about you and I and what we believe in. Not a
well,
fan.
That's the stereotypical high school crap, right? Like, wasn't Sharpay kind of a bitch?
Oh,
she
yeah.
She was supposed to be the popular girl.
She was a totes bitch. And then author Orion then goes on to describe how gorgeous Jordan is. So it's not that she's rich or connected. She's popular because everybody wants to bang her. And I'm always interested in how they sort of sneak race into these things. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes they, like, just come out and quickly say it and then they're done. This time, they just mentioned that she has perfect coffee-colored skin and her dark brown eyes are twinkling.
So awful. When, it's like she was like Cleopatra, a perfect African princess or something. Like, that would
never,
be better. I
never,
don't know.
Very,
just
never
say
very,
it, guys. Come
never
on.
Never very subtle.
We still haven't gotten to the actual book movie yet. I just have to insert that.
Oh, really?
None of this is in the movie.
I did watch the movie, but... Yeah, I don't remember much of it. Another meeting means a long explanation of the prom photo backdrop. There's failed attempts at a backdrop. They talk about what they're going for. They talk about how a backdrop functions. Here's a quote. Couples are going to stand in front of this and take pictures they'll look at for the rest of their lives. See, this is your prom primer. This is for, like, kindergartners that know that they'll be at prom someday and have to get the basics down. And then there's test photos with Nova and Brandon. A little bit of tension there, Lauren.
Ooh.
With those two, yeah.
Let's read about it.
Yeah, we know they're meant to be together because...
With Nova's honey-colored highlights and Brandon's copper hair, they certainly made a beautiful couple.
What does the hair look like together? That's my biggest concern when picking a prom date.
But wouldn't copper hair turn green over time?
Could do, yes. Look, but the meeting's not over. Don't relax. This is still business. They now look at various posters and give their opinions. And bizarrely, a poster that screamed pink and was filled with hearts and rainbows is turned down because it will turn off the guys. Way to gender stereotype there, Nova. I think that would be fun, especially if it was like, you know, a unicorn shooting like rainbows and stuff like that. I think that would be excellent.
That would be awesome. I think kids like that sort of stuff nowadays, right? With like Nyan cat.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Now it's like lasers, cats, space, bacon. All you need.
bacon.
And we're not over these posters yet. Don't relax about these posters, because in the next chapter, they pick up the posters from the printer, and then they get excited about the posters, and then they make a plan of how they're going to put the posters up, and then Brandon comes up and talks about how much he loves the posters. I mean, seriously. But...
Yeah. I do have some friends who are font nerds, actually. So that's a real thing.
I like that, though. Do you like that? Do you find that... They're cool friends, right?
Yeah.
I get a friend at work. She's great. She's cool. She likes a lot of cool stuff. And she went and saw Guardians of the Galaxy, which isn't the sort of film she'd normally see. And I said, what did you think of it? She said, I loved it. I love the font. And I just love that. I was like, yeah, like what a great thing.
We had a professor in seminary who did all his PowerPoint presentations in papyrus font.
Oh, you know what that yeah.
is? You can't see it on the screen. It was horrible. So all my friends would go, oh no, papyrus.
we use a lot of fonts at work, and one of the ladies there had this font which she'd made some lettering out of for a display, and I was looking at this lettering and I was like, it's really kind of puffy and tapered at the ends. And then I thought about it a while and I thought, oh, I know what that looks like. And then I looked it up. It was called defecay font. And every letter was like a coiled turd, and she never realized this. And I was like, "Yeah, I don't think we're going to use that one." And she's like, "I like it because it's puffy." And I'm like, "It's a lot of things."
I used to have a font called Buffied, and it was the Buffy the Vampire Slayer logo font with the pointy,
blood
dripping off. That got lost along the way. So, okay, this is where the movie starts. With the motorcycle guy.
The fun is all broken up by this a-hole right here.
Oh, yeah. The motorcycle guy who tried to steal her spot was standing just a few feet away, putting his helmet in his locker! Exclamation point for some reason. Without the helmet, Nova recognized him at once. Jesse Richter, the resident bad boy of Brookside Senior Class. She should have known.
Uh-oh. Bad boys, bad boys. What are you going to do when they come for you, Lauren?
Oh, jeez. But he's dreamy.
He is? He's so dreamy. His hair, my God. He's waving it around.
It's long, but it's not too long that it's like stringy, but it's long enough to be edgy.
I just wanted to run my hands through it. I couldn't focus on anything else once he came into this thing.
And I don't feel so bad because he's probably really like 30 in real life. So guys, don't get all your, you know, pervy radar is up in a bunch here.
But popularity isn't important, as we learned. But, so, you know, you could go, his sister Tess pointed out. For a freshman, Tess was really cool. And pretty popular, too. The total opposite of Lloyd, who'd perfected the art of geeky quietness back in fifth grade. So now she's dissing the nerds.
Even if the guy was a geeky, quiet guy, he'd still have friends who were girls.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So, I don't know. This whole thing is, like, weird.
All my friends are girls.
All my friends are guys.
Tess convinces him that going to prom is the last chance to make anyone remember you even went there. I kind of remember anybody having that sort of impact at a school ball.
Yeah,
where I ignored them for 5 years and then they walked in their tuxedo and I just went, oh, you've arrived, pal. You'd have to have, like, Scarlett Johansson or someone on your arm.
Of course you would say Scarlett Johansson.
Just off the top of my head, it was the first name I thought of.
Uh-huh. Well, I remember at my junior prom, Luke Guidi, who's kind of like the class clown, he tripped and fell onto a tray of dinners.
This isn't going like to 20... end in death again. Yeah. Is that like your other story?
No. no death. He tripped and fell, and there was like a tray of like 20 or 30 dinners sitting on it, to get handed out, and the whole tray crashed down on the floor. And he did that movie thing where he, like, paused, looked, and then he put his hands in his pocket and kind of strolled away.
Got into his little car with 30 of his friends and went back to the circus.
And the poor waitress had to clean it all up.
Well, here's a new character. This is Jordan's boyfriend. Remember, Jordan was the most popular girl in school. This is Tyler Basso.
Everything from his close-cropped hair to his brand new shoes projected confidence and style.
Forget personality. How about those shoes, huh? Amazing.
Oh, the thing is, they don't mention his skin color here.
Did that make you uncomfortable in the film? Because I sort of came out of it thinking this is a film about prom where white couples, Asian couples, and black couples can go to the prom and have a good time together. Like, there was no one was mixed up.
Yeah. And he's the bad guy, as we'll see.
Spoilers.
He's the villain of the book, spoiler, and he's black.
Because Jordan finds an earring in Tyler's car, but he's like, oh, it's cool. It's just because I drove half the girls' soccer team to Papagino's last week. That makes it cool?
Papagino's is a real pizza chain in Massachusetts where I grew up, so I was happy.
Isn't that like saying, though, you know, someone finds a bra in your bedroom and you go, oh, yeah, that's just because I had, like, the cheerleaders in here the other week. And they go, okay, that explains it.
My sister was changing in my room. I don't know. This is just...
Jordan is going to make her boyfriend ask her to prom. And he has to make a big deal of it, too. It's not like an assumed thing. We're a couple. We'll be going together. He has to actually do a promposal.
Yeah, I don't understand this promposal stuff. Like, hey, you want to go to prom? Yeah, okay, let's go.
I remember hearing this term probably a couple of years ago, and I wonder if it was in relation to this film, because the promposals are pretty full-on in this.
Maybe. They do that nowadays online, those darn kids. Make little videos and stuff.
Weird. And yet more characters. These are two sophomore guys. So they're, what, year 10?
Second year of high school. Year 9. 10.
10. Corey Doyle and Lucas Arnaz, who are obsessed with a band called Stick Hippo. And Lucas likes lab partner Simone. And I'm guessing that something's going to happen with all these guys at some kind of prom. I had to put them down just in case they come up later.
Yeah, but sophomores can't go to the prom unless a senior takes them, so.
Well, let's see what happens, because I've got a good feeling about these two. I think they've got a big future. And then, but didn't you find, like, everyone in this book was just so insipid, dumb, and boring? Here's an example of some of the dialogue.
I love us, May declared as they examined their work. Right then, May's boyfriend Justin arrived.
Nice tea, he said casually when he noticed the cute little Mickey Mouse t-shirt that was part of May's eclectic outfit. Could he be any more of a Disney shill? That's like saying, I can't wait for prom, and also Frozen to hit Blu-ray. Such a great film. I can't stop singing the songs.
I can't wait for the Song of the South to get its Blu-ray release.
Yeah, but seriously, like, you know, if your husband came in and said, nice tea, wouldn't you punch him in the face?
Maybe. Unless it was a t-shirt he gave me as a present, because that is a thing we do.
But nice tea? Nice tea? A tea?
Yeah.
So that's weird.
T-shirt.
It's weird to me.
It is weird. I don't know. Maybe it's not so weird to us.
All right. So Jesse Richter is warned by the principal for cutting class every afternoon. And didn't you find this a bit sinister in the film? Like, he's the one that's not going to class, but the principal's got this really, like, awful attitude about it. Like, the scene's played as though the principal's the bad guy and he's all like, you know, you're not going to amount to anything or whatever. And Jesse's all like, yeah, but I'm an individual and I'll, like, do what I want kind of thing. And I feel like we're supposed to side with the person that's not going to school. Is that anti-intellectualism?
Well, no, it's anti-authoritarianism, I think. And the principal says horrible things to this kid that if a real principal ever said... would be fired. You can't say, like, you're never going to amount to anything to a kid. That's awful. Also, the actor that they have playing the principal is usually a villain.
I agree, but it's not like this is a documentary where that's what the principal was like. I mean, Disney has decided that the principal is going to say dickish things and that the kid that's cutting class is going to be the hero.
That's right, because he has a really good reason for cutting class.
We don't know that yet.
I know, foreshadowing.
It's because life is tough. Because it's hard.
Yeah, it's hard. It's Disney hard.
He goes to the
He goes to
the school of hard knocks. Speaking of not real hard, there were high fives all around as the prom committee celebrated the end of weeks, no months of hard work. There are two depressing things I can think of right now, and they're both at complete opposite ends of the scale. One is starving kids in Africa. Two is peppy kids in America giving group high fives. Both of them just make me uncomfortable.
I think it's more depressing is starving kids in America while American kids are giving each other's high fives.
Yes.
It's like, ugh.
And your favorite, Rollo, he mentions his mysterious Canadian girlfriend, Athena, who he will be taking to the prom.
Allie just shook her head and grinned. She had learned not to pay too much attention to Rollo's weird remarks.
Yep, Disney says it's cool to shun difference. He's just weird, because he says weird things that are different from us. And then we see the dumb ways that people propose. These are the promposals. Justin takes May.
Of course they had to name her May. Like, May. Could you not name her something else?
May Kwan.
She's Asian.
May Kwan was the way of not specifically saying that she was Asian. Yeah. He takes her to a theater where these huge wooden spotlit letters spell out prom as he recites his shitty acrostic poem. And here's my version of it. P is for padding about posters in endless committee meetings. R is for ridiculous characters I don't give a shit about. O is for OMFG, is this over yet? And M is for Mickey Mouse, must buy Mickey Mouse products. Maybe a tea. maybe a nice tea. In fact, I would have loved it if the scene kept going. Like, I is for inkling that I have that you're sleeping around. S for is the slutty photos on your Facebook. C is for cheating with other men. And it all spells out promiscuous across the stage. And he breaks up with her. I think that would have been fantastic. But just me.
Yeah, that would have spiced up the movie a bit.
Conversely, though, Brandon, dreamy Brandon, hair full of gel, gives a very shitty proposal suggesting that they carpool as committee members in order to lessen their carbon footprint.
That's more of a realistic promposal, I think.
Would you prefer realistic or romantic?
I don't know. Me for prom? Realistic. I'm kind of a, you know, stickler for the rules. Let's do it. Let's just get it done. I'm very efficient.
I like it.
no mucking about.
Unlike this, in the movie, there's a pyramid of cheerleaders who hold up giant letter placards that say, Ashley, prom? And in the book, there's a friggin' picture, a drawing of these signs in a pyramid shape to show us what's going on. That's breaking the rules. You can't just suddenly do that. Actually, it's very Vonnegut. Have you ever read Breakfast of Champions?
No.
Kurt Vonnegut, like in that book, he's like, oh, I'm old and immature and I just want to do what I want. I feel like drawing an asshole. And then he'll like draw an asshole. And there's just pictures, all these little doodlings like throughout the book. It's crazy.
I'm going to write that book down.
Breakfast of Champions.
I'm going to get this book. Good thing my husband works at a library.
Mm.
Yeah, and you know, I did not get a picture in my book. Had no pictures. So I was totally cheated.
You were robbed.
You made me do this book, and you didn't give me any photo section.
No, there was no photo section. Or e-books, you know. What can you do? Meanwhile, badass Jesse Richter goes home and has to look after his little brother, and he has a waitress mom who probably makes 25 cents an hour. And again, this is really sinister. Jesse hadn't been so annoyed since he'd sat across from Principal Dunnan that morning. It bothered him a lot to think that somebody had been poking around in the basement. It was better to forget all about everything that was stored there. What, like, a mound of dead hitchhikers? What is he hiding?
Is that a euphemism? Poking around in the basement?
Yeah. Is this the Sixth Sense? Is, like, he a ghost?
Oh, I know. It's his evidence dungeon. He's a serial killer. He's really a serial killer, and that's his evidence dungeon.
There's always a catch with these dreamy boys. There's always something wrong with them. In his case, he kills hitchhikers. And Cool Shoes Tyler asked popular girl Jordan to the prom by staging his own prom in the shed filled with all the decorations that have already been made, and he lights it with candles and...
And what's a prom without a romantic dinner? Tyler asked. He led Jordan around the fountain to a picnic blanket let out with two cups of soda and two enormous burritos.
Sounds like a romantic evening of bloating and gas. Love it. No hamburgers, though.
We did have burgers. Two enormous logs.
But idiot Tyler, he leaves a candle flickering when they leave and the whole shed catches fire.
The tree burst into flames, and seconds later, the fire began to lick at the centerpieces.
Who doesn't want their centerpiece licked? So, disaster! That's my unintentional comedy corner. Disaster follows. Nova is distraught. Everyone is too busy with, you're not going to believe this, but schoolwork to help redo. I know! They're working on their grades and their tests. They're too busy to redo prom again.
You left out the best line in the whole
book. Oh, what's that?
When Rallo comes in, he goes, "Wow, apocalypse prom." Mm. That's like the one smart reference in the book.
that would be a good theme. Like, I like that. I think that would be fantastic. They should have
charred all the charred decorations up, and they can put some jungle flowers, and they can get a big fat guy to dress up as Marlon Brando and sit in the corner.
I was thinking maybe a bit of Beyond Thunderdome kind of style, post-apocalypse. People, instead of getting limos, turn up in these, like, tricked-out crazy cars with spikes all over them. They were all wearing Tina Turner wigs.
Nice. Two would go in, one come out.
Yeah, they would have had an excellent time. But these kids have no imagination. But look, this is where it really gets weird. Jesse bad boy Richter shows up on his bike and Principal Dunnan starts yelling at him for no particular reason. This is so out of the blue that even the author is confused at this point.
Jesse glanced around and there were at least 100 students gawking at the mess. Why was he being singled out?
Why indeed? Good point, Ellie O'Ryan. And this is the most bizarre thing of all. Principal Dunnan observed with a mean smile, "You want to graduate? Then from now on until prom, you will spend every waking hour developing an appreciation for just how much work went into this project." So he actually threatens him. He will not be able to graduate unless he spends all his time making prom decorations instead of doing schoolwork. What kind of a system is that? Can a principal do that?
Maybe. I don't know. That's so weird. Like, normally if you're missing school and stuff, they'll make you, like, do a research project.
I can't imagine, you know? Like, you know, you're missing school and someone says, look, in order to pass school, that'd be like going, you have to mow all the lawns in the school in order to pass. Like, it's just so arbitrary and has nothing to do with the curriculum or anything that is. It's ridiculous. Look, school in America is weird. Like, now Lucas and Corey are walking around everywhere in helmets because varsity is making them. What does that even mean? What does that mean, Lauren? what's varsity? Well, why do they have to wear helmets?
I'll tell you. Varsity is like the best of the best athletes. You have like the varsity football team and the junior varsity football team. So like everybody tries out for the team and the best players are on varsity and the other players who are not as good but have potential are on junior varsity. And the poor bastards that get cut just suck. But so this is a hazing thing.
Hazing.
But it would never be allowed in real life anymore. They're very strict about that sort of thing. They would just take them out back behind the school on the weekend and make them chug 10 beers.
What's with Disney and their comedy hazing? I
don't know.
Where's the protest there? All right, do you remember that geek Lloyd and his sister Tess? She's the cool, popular one, apparently, but all her advice is absolute nonsense.
Tess glanced up again. The ask. You know, whatever special thing you do to ask her. She replied, "It has to be amazing. Unforgettable. You can't just be all, hey, want to go to the prom with me? That would be such a fail."
What do these women want? I don't even think Mel Gibson could figure out what these women want. This is a very, very complex arrangement here. Mm. I find this very intimidating. And, of course, Lloyd's first plan, Complete failure. Doesn't work at all. Both girls started to look around suspiciously, trying to figure out who had vandalized her locker with the scary-looking letters. Lloyd knew that was his cue to leave. Fast. And chapter 7 opens with this.
Luckily for Lloyd, most people seem to forget about the creepy message on Alice's locker by lunchtime.
I reckon that might be the funniest part of the film, where she's like, who would put serial killer letters on my locker?
All of Lloyd's antics are delightful in the movie, but in the book, it just kind of doesn't
falls a bit flat. Well. That happens a lot in novelizations. That's like, you know, it's the flubber syndrome. When Robin Williams is delightful in the film, but in the book, he just seems like an asshole. Same with Bill Cosby and Ghost Dad.
Yeah, I remember Ghost Dad. Big fan, fan over here.
That was episode 50. Can you believe that? And this is episode 98.
Oh, I'm not 100?
No, nearly. We're very close.
No, Jess has to be 100.
Jess will be 100. Mm-hmm. I know what film we're doing too. I'm going to tell you after we finish
this. Okay, good. Spoiler alert.
Spoilers. So Jesse helps Nova in the art room, and he has big muscles and dark hair in his face, and I just can't imagine how all this is going to turn out. These two are just so unlike each other, Nova and Bad Boy Jesse. I can't see anything happening between them, but...
Yeah, me either. But Nova, her name is so dumb, I can't even say it. All right. Me. Nova focused on slowing her beating heart and just glared at him as she reached down to pick up the bucket. Why would she feel flustered around Jesse? She liked Brandon. Smart, dependable, level-headed Brandon. Jesse was nothing but a loser.
Breaking news. High school girl falls for good-looking loser. I'm surprised he doesn't have an orange mullet at this point.
Mm. The dreamy, misunderstood bad boy who needs saving.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then Brandon reveals that he's a finalist for the Dean's Scholarship at Princeton, which is big, right? That's really good news. But the interview is the same weekend as the prom, and because all Nova thinks about is the prom, she's suddenly no longer happy for him at all.
But being stranded without a date, less than 3 weeks before prom, by the guy she'd been falling for all spring, that was a disaster even Nova was unprepared to face.
A first world white person disaster. A Disney disaster, if you will.
Yeah, the worst thing that could ever happen.
To a young girl. And Lucas is watching Simone in chemistry class. And I felt like Ellie O'Ryan is kind of naive here, because in science, I sat next to a girl that I had a crush on. This was actually the girl that I asked to the ball who didn't go with me. And I wasn't thinking of her gorgeous hair shining in the sunlight. But you are all hormones at that age. I don't know if hair and golden sunlight and everything is even part of it.
Yeah.
But everybody has huge problems at this point. May has been accepted into Parsons School of Design with Tim Gunn. And she's going to have to move away from Justin, a guy she only knows through high school and has pretty much just held hands with, but she knows they're meant to be together forever, right?
Yeah, all high school relationships are permanent. You know, I have two friends. Here you go. They both married their high school boyfriends.
That's sick.
One set is still together. They're very happy. The other set's divorced. So through my deep research that I did, 50% of them end in divorce. There you go.
Actually, you know what? On reflecting on this, I quite like Jesse, because he says exactly what I was actually thinking. A hurricane is a disaster, Jesse corrected Nova. Smallpox, locusts, those are disasters. This is just a fountain, and it's just a prom. Woo, yes!
With a reason.
You said it, Jesse. We're never going to see this guy at that stupid prom, right? No way. Not our Jesse. He wouldn't be seen dead at that prom. And I reckon this whole thing is going to be, it's going to end with him driving away from the prom, giving them the bird.
Yeah.
Triumphant.
It's going to be like the end of The Graduate. He's going to grab her out of there, and then they're going to get on the bus and drive away in silence.
I like it. Lucas takes Simone to a barbecue, but she doesn't realize that Tyler will be there, and everything gets awkward because, you know, she was the one that left the earring in the car with Tyler. I don't think anyone's keeping track of this anymore. But forget,
yeah,
forget all that stupid teenage shit, because this is the moment that I've been waiting for a while now. Brace yourself, Lauren. Here we go. Do you want to do the honors here?
Yes. The smoky smell of the grill hung heavily in the air, making Lucas realize how hungry he was. He noticed a long table full of chips, brownies, burgers, and hot dogs, and wondered when he could head over there to fix up a plate.
Girls are one thing, but burgers and hot dogs together? That's the perfect, that's the king and queen of the prom, in my opinion.
Pink slime and nitrates.
Yeah, that's what he's really lusting after. If I was putting in a ballot for the court, hot dog for prom king, burger for prom queen. I want to see those two get together.
Pig parts, yum.
And Simone rejects Tyler, and then her and Lucas bond over the most important thing in the world.
Simone and Lucas fixed up some burgers and filled their plates with sides.
Yeah, I like this repetition of this idea of fixing up. He wanted to fix up a plate, and then they fixed up some burgers. Not something in my own vernacular, so I thought that was quite interesting. It came up twice.
I'm disappointed. I wanted to hear what the sides were.
Yeah, that's true. It leaves a lot to the imagination. I guess the reader can imagine their own favorite side.
I guess. Potato salad.
Is this some out-of-context comedy corner, do you think? Lloyd awkwardly tried to stick the pencil into one of Kristen's pockets, but gave up pretty quickly.
Yes, considering I forgot who Kristen was, and I was like, what the hell are you talking about?
Sometimes you need someone to guide you.
That was kind of a funny part in the movie. That's the girl with the boyfriend, Cranton or something, and they're making out. That was pretty funny.
Kristen and Anton. They were such a couple that they were Cranton. And then Jesse fixes the fountain. This is the centerpiece that was going to be licked at the prom. As Nova gasped in surprise, Jesse stepped out from behind the exquisite fountain. The reflection from the water danced over his face, highlighting the question in his eyes. Ooh, riddle me this, Jesse. I don't know what the question was.
Could I sneak out this fart without her noticing or something like that? I hope she doesn't notice my boner.
I always think that when it's like a really romantic scene, when people are just being completely unnaturally unhuman, you think, I wonder what really is happening there. And this sentence was a little bit ironic in my opinion.
She wasn't just another prom-obsessed airhead like so many other girls he knew.
She says prom like 1,000 times a minute. That's crazy.
It's promfastic.
It is absolutely promtabulous. And then Simone ditches Lucas, ends up back in a car with Tyler, kisses him, and then Jordan, the popular girl, sees it, and then Nova finds out that the rival prom has a similar theme, so Jesse and her take off on the motorcycle and they break into the rival school in order to check it out, and then they nearly kiss, and then they get sprung by a janitor, and...
He steered his motorcycle over to the side of the road as a police car pulled up behind them. So hardcore, more like so busted.
That's like that. Who's, is it a Miley Cyrus movie, So Undercover? It's one of those might be so busted.
Yeah, and the bad boy always pulls over at a reasonable speed and produces his license and registration.
So Raven.
Always.
And then Simone and Lucas make amends. And the oblivious Justin gives May a charm bracelet that belonged to his mother, and he talks about their future plans, not knowing that she's going to be hanging out with Tim Gunn, making it work, but...
The smile vanished from May's face. Suddenly, the beautiful bracelet was transformed into something bigger. The charms on it carried the weight of promises she wasn't sure she should keep.
That's a clumsy old metaphor right
there. It should have said it turned into a shackle weighing her down.
Oh, yes! Right? Yes, a ball and chain. You should. And then, this is going to surprise you, but more dumb shit happens. Not the least of which is...
At that moment, the room filled with laughter from a booth against the opposite wall. Everyone turned to see a group of college students building a food tower. Sandwiches stacked on pizza topped with chocolate cake. Condiments oozing all over the whole mess. Suddenly, it toppled over, spilling food everywhere. The guys cracked up.
America, land of plenty. Making a food tower and knocking it over just because you can.
Well, I have to correct something here.
Okay.
They're at a diner, right? Diners don't serve pizza. Maybe in a dreamland, diners serve pizza. But you know what the best thing to get at the diner is?
No.
Disco fries. You don't know what disco fries are?
No, I don't. I'm intrigued. They're the best.
Well, in my youth, I was a club rat and would go clubbing every night. And literally.
Even like a Wednesday?
Yeah, every night we would go into Manhattan and party all night. Go to open bar, drink as much as possible for the 1 hour of free drinks for ladies. And then dance until 4 in the morning. And then at 4 in the morning, you go to the diner, right?
Disco fries.
And you get disco fries, which is French fries with melted cheese and gravy.
Oh, that sounds good, actually. What's the clever thing, though, for disco? Why?
That's just what we called them.
Is it called that because people have, like, been to a disco and then, you know, after you've been out all night, that's what you eat?
Probably. I don't know, actually, where that came from. We just did it, but disco fries.
Disco fries. Best.
And then you can boot and rally.
So pizza, it has to be from I've learned this from novelizations, a parlor or a palace.
Right, or a roller rink.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Well, pizzas require a different type of oven, so I've never been to a diner that had pizza. If they did, if somebody opens a diner with pizza and everything else, I think that they would be, you know, rolling in dough.
When I went... rolling in dough, listeners. Rolling in dough. Well, I'll be jiggered. I went to a Denny's in America in the early hours of the morning.
And I was over my hammy?
No, I can't remember what I had. And I went to a IHOP.
Mm-hmm.
And a Taco Bell. You know, we don't have Taco Bell here in Perth.
Good. Taco Bell is disgusting.
Yeah, it's pretty good. It was pretty great.
Run for the bathroom.
Oh my god. Like, I went into one of those bathrooms in Burger King in America. And I swear, like, the door was missing and this thing looked like it had exploded from the inside. It was crazy.
Starbucks has the best.
A cow had exploded in there. We get a trying on a dress montage of all things, that, which doesn't work as well in a book, I've got to say.
No
catchy music or whatever. Jesse decided it was time to help Nova out. He grabbed a super slinky black dress that wasn't much more than a scrap of fabric and passed it to her around the dressing room curtain. She shoved it back at him immediately. His version of helping was not helpful. Tassel, something crotchless. Come on, Nova, it's the prom. This was a night you wanted to remember. Why not commit?
Well, aren't all dresses crotchless?
You've just blown my mind.
Sorry.
This made everything a little bit more exciting. Meanwhile, May.
That.
Poor old May.
Oh,
everything was such a wreck. Her dress, her hair, her life. These problems were too big for her to fix.
Yeah, her hair, oh.
I wouldn't give her problems to a monkey on a rock. That sounds just disastrous. So look, all these issues. Justin thinks May doesn't want to go to prom with him. She just wants to go with Tim Gunn. Crazy Simone wants to go to prom with the cheating Tyler. Has she not learned anything? Nova's father visits Jesse and tells him not to go to the prom with Nova because he's a bad guy from the wrong side of the tracks and she's got potential. And then Jesse tells Nova that he's a bad guy who's going nowhere and he won't go with her to this prom that he didn't want to go to anyway.
Yeah, like Disney's bad guy? I'm like, yeah, a guy who cares about his family, who works hard and helps raise his little brother is terrible. What an awful person.
I think he's going to end up not at the prom, because we know he's not interested in the prom. I think he'll end up in jail or something like that. We'll see.
Yeah.
But this is also happening.
Meanwhile, Simone sat across from Tyler in a booth at the local pizza place, sharing a pie loaded with toppings.
Why aren't all these kids obese? Like, their lifestyle. I guess at that age, you're kind of growing and you can eat a lot of crazy shit. But, oh my, they should at least have, like, beards of acne or something.
Yeah. I did.
Me too. And then Jesse gets beaten up by college kids. And then the night before prom, Nova...
With shaking hands, Nova ripped the poster off the wall and tore it up as a choking sob rose in her throat. She fell onto her bed, weeping into one of the soft pillows as the torn-up poster fluttered around her, destroyed like all her dreams for prom.
Man, I thought I knew this Nova character. I thought she was going to do it for the prom. I can't believe she ripped up those posters we read a whole chapter about.
Oh, and I love how her pillows are soft. We have to be told that they're soft pillows.
Her dirty pillows.
Yeah.
And then it is prom night. Finally, we made it. This is a longer lead up than 30 days of night. Justin and May, they make up and they go to prom together. Jordan goes alone because she's, no, you didn't, girlfriend. She's going to go by herself. Brandon shows up. He got out of his interview early from Princeton. Lucas and Corey ditch prom. I guess they couldn't have gone into prom anyway. I just misinterpreted that. So they go and see Hippo stick together. Bros before pros. Stick Hippo, yeah. They were good too. they supported Hippo's stick. And then the king and the queen are announced. And it's hot dog and burger.
Yeah.
No,
the crowd cheered as Tyler broke away from Simone. He made his way toward the stage, getting high fives and back slaps from practically everyone.
And Jordan is queen, but she refuses to dance with this guy who cheated on her. And then Simone, even though she went to the party with it, prom with him, she rejects him too in front of all these people.
The DJ started up another song and the crowd moved back onto the dance floor, shuffling Tyler off to the side where he stood awkwardly, totally irrelevant and totally alone.
How fickle is this crowd? Like, 1 second it's high fives and back slaps and then he is totally ostracized, like in seconds.
Yeah, that's high school for ya.
You said it, sister. And then Simone leaves and finds Lucas. She's going to go for the, what was he, a freshman, a sophomore, or a varsity?
10th grade, 10th grader.
A freshmore, a varsman. And back at the prom, this was the thing that surprised me out of everything in the book. The unthinkable happens.
I think I'm prommed out, Nova said.
That would be like Zac Efron not being interested in basketball in a High School Musical. I will not accept that Nova is prommed out. She's got to have that little bit of prom left in her. Got to search inside and find that inner prom. But here we go. Holy shit.
But there he was, stepping out from behind the fountain, wearing his dad's tuxedo and looking more handsome than anyone could have imagined.
I don't know. I can imagine pretty handsome. Jesse Richter, bad boy Jesse, is here. Who saw that coming? I didn't think this guy would ever end up at prom. I thought he'd end up in jail or dead in a ditch or being chased by cops. He's at prom in a monkey suit.
I know. I thought he'd be surfing on top of a van or anything else those kids do.
Oh, like Teen Wolf.
Yeah, I love Teen Wolf.
This is the most unpredictable story Disney has ever produced. What a twist. This is like M. Night Shyamalan would just be like... Fuck, he went to the prom? That's weird. That's weirder than the village.
And they're all ghosts.
And they're all ghosts, yeah.
It's implied.
Let's read the ending. We'll take turns at these parts. We actually got there, everybody. I feel like, you know, with a new person, a new guest, a first timer, I feel like the book's just so unimportant, Lauren. I just wanted to speak to you, get to know you. You know, the book was just here in the background. These lives, these high school lives just pale in comparison, in significance to the meeting of our two countries. Because everyone says, oh, you know, you're all like with America and stuff. We love America. And look at this gesture reaching. This is like a kangaroo shaking hands with an eagle by the talon.
Right.
That's exactly what it's like.
It's been fun. It's been fun. I know. I'm blushing after all your lovely words.
Oh, My lovely words, like...
I'm at a loss for words. You caught me off guard.
here's the ending. Let's share this.
Let's do it.
And that was when Nova realized the truth about prom. Dropping some truth prom bombs here. It really was a night to hold on to, but sometimes the best way to do that was to let go.
Let it go. When the music slowed down, Jesse drew Nova tighter into his arms. He reached into his pocket and slipped the candy necklace over her head. The pastel colored the pastel colored sugar beads rested in the hollow of her throat, but Jesse didn't notice them.
He couldn't take his eyes off her lips.
You're about to kiss me, Nova whispered.
Told you you'd know, Jesse whispered back. He leaned in slowly, and then his lips were on hers, and it was perfect, the way Nova had dreamed it would be. It was a kiss she would remember forever.
And a night she'd never forget.
Because of the unwanted pregnancy that happened.
That's how you get pregnant? Kissing?
At the prom, yep. Absolutely.
And I bet somebody had a baby in the bathroom. That happens a lot these days.
She had a baby in the bathroom. Principal Dunham found her trying to flush it, and it was not. And he sentenced her to cutting all the hedges at the school.
But that's prom 2, Electric Boogaloo.
Oh, I would love that. Mm. So that was prom. We went to the prom. We did all the prom things. Got to ask you, as I always do at this point, was the book better?
No. The movie was better.
I'm gonna agree. I'm gonna agree with you.
It was shorter. It was lighter.
Yeah.
All the wacky gags were funny.
Had these serial killer letters. Yeah. I like the prom better.
The stoner guy was cute and funny. He was the best part of the movie, the stoner guy. The non-stoned stoner guy.
I would just say that the movie was better because of Jesse Richter's fabulous hair. He was kind of a bit Winter Soldier. I just thought he was just stunning.
That's true. He is very cutie pie.
Hang on a second. I'm just thinking about Jesse Richter. Sorry. Mm. Go on. Okay. Mm. Amazon reviews. There were some Amazon reviews. he's just a couple. Number one, love this book. It's just like the great movie and is a great book for young teens and people who watch the movie. So yes. Yeah. So if you love the movie and you love the book, then this is great for you. That's high praise. Sometimes you just need, you know, you have an inkling that that'll be the case, but you need someone to confirm it for you. This is the last one. Such a good book. I would totally recommend this book to a friend. You won't regret getting this book. I like this book so much, I stayed up to 1:47 in the morning on a school night. I just couldn't get my hands off it. Talking about his knob. Each time I would hesitate to put my Kindle down. Well, up to
that's
one.
That's what the kids are calling it these days.
1:47, yeah. 1:47, bashing away at that Kindle on a school night. That, if that isn't high praise.
I bet he was late for his prom committee meeting.
Yeah. Or she. Talking about those posters. Could have been a she. Could have been a she.
Probably a she.
Probably
these things are usually focused at girls.
Girls like prom. I'm gonna write that down. That could be useful.
Yeah.
What women
truth
want
bomb.
In my What Women Want diary.
Girls like prom.
It's a prom bomb. Well, we made it, Lauren. Thank you so much for joining me on that. That was.
Thank you. I'm very honored to be here in front of your tens of listeners.
yeah.
just kidding. I'm gonna be famous.
Now you're here, it's substantially less.
I'll listen to myself. Yeah, but I hate the sound of my voice.
Everyone says that. You get used to it. I didn't like the sound of my voice for a while, and now I think it's rich and velvety and easy on the ears.
It is. That's very good. But don't get too full of yourself, or you'll end up like Tyler Barso.
That's
alone
true.
Crying into your pizza.
That is very true. We did learn some lessons, didn't we? About all of that. He was full of the soccer team.
Mm.
No, they were full
they
of
were
him.
Full of him.
Yeah.
Jinx. Okay.
Whoa. So I'm going to do some plugs, some little plug Mick Pluggersons. I've got two other podcasts. You got to listen to them. FP Cast, which is a general pop culture podcast for Fruitless Pursuit, and ScarJo A Go-Go, where I review and debate and discuss every Scarlett Johansson film in chronological order. I think the next one is, I'm trying to think when this is going to come out. It will be An American Rhapsody. Have you ever heard of that film?
No.
She like escapes from Hungary as a baby, and she's a bad baby, and then she turns into Scarlett Johansson.
Oh, well, that's good. I just saw Under the Skin.
Oh, what did you think of that?
It was interesting. And she's naked in it, so.
She is, but like I don't think I really like thought about that as much, like during it. I really like just the some very haunting visuals in that.
It is beautiful. The music is beautiful too.
Yeah. It's very weird. Like, while you're watching it, you're feeling, oh, this is like a little bit slow, or it's, you know, it's not really going anywhere, but it really sticks with you. Like, the more I thought about it afterwards, the more I really liked it.
Yeah, it's based on a book.
Yeah.
Very loosely.
Loosely, yeah.
I figured.
I don't know. Those seduction scenes were really interesting. Very metaphorical. So, look. Do all that. Rate and review us on iTunes. No one ever does that. Do that, you belligerent people. And like our Facebook pages and join the discussion on the book was better, comma, FP cast, comma, Scarlett A Go-Go, ScarJo A Go-Go discussion group on Facebook. Now, people think, I say, you know, and we'll get chatting, we'll get to know each other, it'll be great. People don't think, they think I'm full of shit, they don't think that's going to happen. But look at you and I, Lauren, that's exactly what you did. You joined the group, we got to know each other, and now you're the star of The Book Was Better.
Right, it could happen to you, folks.
It could happen to you, people. Probably won't, because, you know, Lauren's very special. But
oh, can I plug my blog?
Please do. I should have asked you. I had 100% intention of asking you to plug, but I should have let you do it first. It was very rude of me.
That's okay. Well, I have a blog. It's therevlauren.wordpress.com. It's, you know, Rev, R-E-V, Lauren. Because, why is that, Luke?
Because you get people revved up.
No. Oh, because I'm a priest, and the Rev Lauren is where I post my sermons and my various adventures in ministry.
You are the absolute coolest priest I know.
Thanks. How many do you know?
Two.
Yeah.
So that's good. Like, it's 50, you know, 50, I've done my research. 50-50. Yeah. No. Very cool. And yeah, so thank you
good thing we
very,
plugged
very
at the
much.
End.
For doing that. Well, you were good. You were behaved. If anyone was poorly behaved, it was me. It wasn't you. And please, anyone listening, do not let my horrible, immature Australian behaviour be a poor reflection on Lauren, because she's always fantastic. And I've actually tried to behave more than usual, so that's good.
I don't mind, but I do get Googled a lot, so you never know.
I Googled The Book Was Better the other day, and someone was recommending the podcast on a thread, which is fantastic. Like, I'm very grateful to this person for doing that, because people are asking for podcast recommendations. But they said it was a particularly stupid podcast full of immature Australian humor.
So there
you go. I thought we were actually really, like, intelligent and, you know, stuff.
Oh, don't take it things. To heart. They just probably didn't understand it.
That's true, because it's right? very... It works on a lot of levels. You think this is really lowbrow, but sometimes, you know, a lowbrow is just a highbrow relaxing.
Yeah, and then you talk about Kurt Vonnegut and it just brings it right.
Oh, yeah, exactly. It's a mix. You never know what you're going to get. Well, look, thank you so much. Anything else you want to throw in before we do the flips?
No, love you guys.
Me too. So, do you want to say the thing?
Can I?
Yeah.
Yay.
Absolutely.
I'll
That's
catch
guess.
You.
Yeah, guest privilege. I just interrupted. I just screwed it up for you by interrupting you, but you can do it again.
Okay. And I'll catch you on the flips.
Jumanji.
Prom.